and you want a copy of that RISC inode within the inode cache. So that is the goal of IGET. So if you remember how the inode table or inode cache is organized, it's basically a hash table. So these are the buckets, and you have buffers here holding different copies of, or holding copies of different disk items. So remember, each of these has identifying information. So a file system ID or a file system number, and the inode number within that file system. So this pair, this we already discussed, that just the inode number is not enough to identify a particular inode. With every file system, your inode numbers will start from 1. So along with the inode number, you also need a file system ID. This pair will tell you or will identify an inode uniquely. So this information is contained over here. And indeed, for IGET, that pair is the input. This pair. Okay, this is also referred to as a logical device number. Each file system, remember, is basically a logical device, so you could call it file system ID or logical device number. It means the same thing. So what are the two possibilities? This inode that we are looking for, it may already be present in the cache or not. So the simpler case is a cache hit. So you use these to work out whatever hash function you have implemented, go to the appropriate bucket and search the corresponding chain. If you find it, then you are mostly done. One additional condition that we will require, that we will talk about a little later. But the simple case is simply a cache hit where you look this up in the hash table and you find the inode you are looking for. Okay. The other possibility is a cache miss. So if there is a cache miss, then what do you have to do? You first have to find space for, I mean, you'll have to read this in from the disk, and you'll have to store it in some buffer within the inode cache. Okay. For that, you need a free buffer in the inode cache. So remember, apart from the hash table, you also have a free list. This points to the buffers in the hash table that have either not been used at all, or if they are storing inodes, then the inodes they are storing are not currently actively in use. So that we understand. Remember, I said that you look at the reference count. The reference count keeps track of how many instances of that file are currently in use. So any block will be on the free list if and only if its reference count is 0. So if you can use, when you know that there is a cache miss and you need a cache block to hold the inode that you are looking for, look up the free list, get the first buffer on the free list, and then you have to read this from the file system or from the disk and then store it in that buffer. Here also, if you think a little more carefully, there are actually two subcases. One is when the free list has one or more buffers. But what if, in the worst case, the free list is also empty? That can also happen. That means basically all the buffers in your inode cache have been allocated to files, and it so happens that all those files are currently actively being used. Okay, then what should we do? One possibility would be to wait until one buffer becomes free. The problem with that is, so this, remember, is somewhere inside the kernel. I mean, basically from an application point of view, what I have done maybe is I have called the open file open function, and inside that somewhere it has called iget, and now iget in this particular situation has not been able to obtain a free buffer in the inode cache, so it is now starting to wait. That means to me, as the if I'm running the program, then my program will seem to basically stop. I mean, it's waiting for something to happen. Question is, how long will it wait? Can the kernel give any kind of guarantee that this will not wait for a very long time? Unfortunately, no. Why? Because what are we waiting for? We are waiting for reference counts to drop to zero. So a reference count will drop to zero if some process that has opened the file closes it. But that is not under kernel control. So if some process opens a file and keeps it open indefinitely, then this iget will also wait for a long time. So that means my program will appear to hang for an indefinitely long time. So rather than do that, and kind of basically because this is deep down somewhere in the kernel, the user application program has no way of knowing what it is stuck doing. So better thing is, if it's kind of, if all the cache buffers are currently occupied and they have all reference count more than zero, then the kernel returns an error. So the application program gets back control, and then it can decide whether to give up or whether to try sleep for some time, maybe print a message, try again after some time. So basically, returning an error message gives back more control to the application program. Okay. The one feature that I had said that I did not talk about so far, but what we really want is I don't just want a pointer to the buffer that holds the inode that I am looking for, but I want which I had not mentioned earlier, but what I want is a locked copy for. I not only want a copy of that in the inode cache, but I want that buffer to be locked so that no other process accesses it. Why is that? Again, basic principle of caching that we talked about yesterday is that any inode may be manipulated by multiple processes simultaneously, but no matter how many processes are accessing an inode, we can have at least one copy of that in the cache. So suppose two or more processes are trying to do something to the inode, the common inode, then again it's the same question of synchronization. I mean, it's a shared data structure that multiple processes are modifying. So then you don't want that shared data structure to become corrupted. So as to prevent that kind of possibility, anytime we do an iget, the kernel marks. So apart from this, there will also be some field over here that keeps track of whether it is locked or free. So what the kernel will return is, it will return a buffer and make sure that the locked field is set. And is, well, of course, first thing it will have to check is that the lock is not already held by some other process. And in that case, it will return a locked copy. It will set the lock field and return a locked copy. So because of this additional requirement, we actually now need to deal with an additional case in our algorithm also. The cache hit case, I have simply said that if you find what you are looking for, you are done. But now, again, there are two cases. You find it, and it is free, then of course you can go ahead. You can lock it and return it to the user. But if it is already locked, then there is some other instance of the file that is in use. So then I can't return a locked copy right now. So what do I do? So basically what you can do is, you can wait until the lock becomes free, block the process until the lock becomes free, and then you try all over again. Okay, so the way of handling a locked inode is a little counterintuitive in some ways. So anyway, first let us talk about the difference between. So think of the cases that we are trying. Case one is, or let me simply write, cache hit. Here there are two suffixes. This is really the simplest case. Again is relatively straightforward, in the sense that if the free list is not empty, then we know that we will take one of the buffers in the free list. We are going to use it to store this particular inode, so you will have to assign it to the appropriate hash queue, and then you will have to read the inode from disk and store it. When the read has completed, you store that inode in the appropriate buffer. You lock it and return it. Because it was not there in the cache, naturally there is no question of it being locked. So this is relatively straightforward. This case we discussed a little while earlier, that if the free list is empty, then you don't know when it will become empty, because it depends on other processes closing the file. So this we are saying return an error. So left is inode is locked. So what I'm saying here is, you wait. So what you should ask about is, over here, the free list was empty, I chose not to wait, instead I returned an error. Over here, the inode is locked and I choose to wait. Why are we dealing with the two situations differently? So that's basically because whether the free list is empty or not, that I said depends on other user control processes. Whereas the locking and unlocking is something that the kernel does in order to ensure consistency of shared data structures. So one principle that the kernel adopts is that a lock will never last across system calls. So anytime, see, basically in a sense, a unit of work that the kernel performs at a time is like a system call. I mean, you get a request, you fulfill that request, and then you wait for the next request. So then whatever work needs to be done will be done in that one system call. So if that system call involves modifying shared data structure, you lock it first, do your work. When the system call's work is finished, you unlock and then return from the system call. So, difference is, this is under process control, user control process. whereas this is under kernel control. So the kernel can actually guarantee that, okay, fine, the inode is locked, but it won't be locked indefinitely. Whatever system call is currently holding the lock for this inode, whenever that system call finishes, then the lock will be released. So because this is under kernel control and this is not under kernel control, the two situations are handled differently.
Sir, can you please give us some examples about the first case, inode is locked? I mean, in a, from a C program, suppose I am opening a file simultaneously, then is it locked, right?
For the duration of the open, it is locked, yes.
Okay.
So what will happen is, say this, I suppose this is the whatever file you want to open concurrently from two different processes, this is the inode buffer that corresponds to that particular inode. Now, two programs, you are calling open two different times, that means there are what? There are two concurrent instances of this file in use, which means that the reference count should be incremented twice. The reference count is also something that is stored within here. Now, what you don't want is that you don't want a race condition to happen so that you really wanted two increments, but the reference count becomes only one. You want to avoid that. I mean, basically it's what? It's ref count plus plus, and this is something that's shared, stored over here. You don't want this to happen concurrently. So because of that, the lock will, I mean, even though to us it appears that the open is happening kind of concurrently, internally the kernel is synchronizing any operation on the inode buffer. So the first, I mean, whichever happens to get the lock first, that will implement the reference count, do whatever else is required in order to open, release, and then the other process will be able to do the open. So apart from opening, the other thing that for us it's easiest to deal with this in terms of opening a file, but notice that something like, say, a CHON or a CHMOD, those also involve changing fields within the inode. So those will also, even though they don't involve an explicit file open, they also will require an internally, I mean, they will require a call to IGET. So if you want to, say, change the permissions on a particular file, first look up the path and obtain the inode number, call IGET with that inode number, so you now have a cache copy of the inode, then change the permission to whatever you like, and then maybe update it on the disk also. Okay, but the main point is something like a reference count, which is shared, you don't want to corrupt that kind of a count.
Sir,
if
the process that is holding the lock on the file, if it fails unexpectedly, that means some exception occurs or something like that, then what happens to the buffer?
So notice that in order for that to happen, the exception would have to happen within the kernel.
Okay.
Which means we are essentially talking about a buggy kernel. So then basically all guarantees are off. But if the kernel has been carefully written and designed, then, I mean, it's designed so that you won't get exceptions from within the kernel. The kernel is supposed to know what to store. Okay, so certain file systems will permit you to use user-level file locking. The problem that you are talking about can arise, that application program creates a user-level lock, and then before releasing it, it dies. So then, I mean, you could do something like design exit so that when a process terminates for whatever reason, just like it takes care of closing all open files, it should also take care of releasing anything that is kind of any resource that it is holding. Yes.
So, from this logic, these partitions, they are usually mounted in flash media.
They are usually mounted in flash media.
So how will it work out? If from the inode it will first go to slash media, right?
Right.
Then after that...
So you're talking about how file systems are mounted and unmounted.
Yes, so...
That's, I think, the last system call that we'll look at in this chapter, so we'll have to be patient for a fairly long time. I mean, after we've looked at open, close, read, write, one of the last function system calls that we'll look is the mount and unmount. So at that point, we'll talk about how if you plug in a pen drive, you get to access a file system that was hitherto not available on the system. Okay, so I'll postpone the answer to that.
What is the need for publishing, putting the error in the second case?
For this one?
Yes.
As I said, I mean, see, the free list will become non-empty when some reference count drops to zero.
Yes.
The kernel can't guarantee when it will drop to zero. Okay. I mean, suppose you do f open some file,
yes,
and then you do while one, nothing. That means you held that file open for, okay, I'm not saying that that's going to happen all the time, but it is impossible, it is in principle a possibility. I mean, think of a program that you write which does f open, while one, semicolon. That file will be held open forever until you kill it. So therefore the kernel cannot guarantee when the free list will become non-empty. So then your program will appear to hang forever. So rather than that, give control back to the user saying that this is the situation, what do you want to do? Abort your program, sleep for some time and try again after some time. Returning an error, that will return control to the user. So the application program decides what it wants.
So what if multiple programs implement f-open? Will it same thing happen?
No, not necessarily. I mean, as long as there is space in the inode buffer, it will work just fine. But I mean, what you could try to do, I'm not sure if, see, there is a quota on each process, a limit on each process as to how many files it can simultaneously keep open. So that number is something like 64. I mean, any single process cannot have more than, say for argument's sake, 64 files open at a time. I don't know if there is this kind of a limit on the total number of files that a particular user can have open. Assuming that limit does not exist, what you can try to do is kind of write a loop fork any number of processes or keep forking processes, and within each process you open the maximum permissible number of files, and you keep doing this, don't close any file and make sure you don't exit from any process. So sooner or later you will reach a limit where you have the maximum possible number of files open on the system. Then if you try to open a file again, check what error message you get.
Will the OS create some problem?
I'm sorry?
Will the operating system crash or something then?
I should hope not. I mean, if it's a reasonably designed operating system, it should not. But I don't know. It's not an experiment I've tried myself. So it's something you could try. I mean, worst case, you'll have to reboot your machine. Yes, you had a question.
Sir, where this inode cache is actually existing?
Main memory.
So whenever we are performing a CH1 or CH mode, we are actually taking the inode from the disk to the memory.
Correct.
And simultaneously, I mean, after just completing the CH mode or CH1, we are again writing it back to the disk.
You could do one of two things. Either you could choose not to. Why that doesn't affect things is that, remember, all accesses to that inode are going to the cache copy.
So suppose we are logging into, suppose there is a network hard disk and we are logging from two different...
Distributed file systems, you need different mechanisms.
No, not actually distributed file system. The memory is there and we are logging from different operating system. Different SSH supports.
Right.
So from one operating system, I've just made some CH1 kind of a thing.
See, if you are talking about SSH,
right,
then remember that the CH1 is happening on the server machine that you've connected.
Right.
So the fact that you are connecting from different clients is not
kind
of significant there. But if you have, what we do have on the fourth floor, you have an network file server.
Right.
there this kind of mechanism will not work.
Right.
You need something else.
Right.
Okay, but that's a whole different topic. So I don't want to get into stateless, stateful, that kind of stuff. But for one machine, it's not a problem because everything will go through the cache first. So as long as that is up to date, it doesn't matter that the disk copy is out. Only thing is, if you get an improper shutdown, then this may not be reflected in the hard disk. So which is why, I mean, there's a trade-off. You can write updates to disk lazily, but then you have a possibility of disk corruption, or I mean, disk being out of it. Right, okay, so to complete this discussion, as I said, I mean, there's a counterintuitive thing that is being done here. You wait until what? Wait until unlock. Or rather, sleep until unlock, specifically. So what does this suggest? That when the inode becomes unlocked, kernel itself will unlock the inode. So then when it is unlocking, it will also know which other processes are waiting for this to become unlocked. Now the intuitive thing to do would be to wake up one of those processes. Then as soon as you wake up from here, you can assume that you have access to the inode and proceed. What the kernel does is, instead of waking up just one waiting process, it will wake up all waiting processes. So that who gets to actually acquire the lock is determined by process priority rather than the order in which the locks happen. So if you have a situation where, say, P0 holds the lock on this inode, and you have P1, P2, P3, all of these waiting for the inode to become unlocked. It is possible that P1 is a low priority process and P2 is a high priority process. If you let them go, or rather if the kernel wakes up processes in first in first out order or first come first served order, then P1 is the next process to get the lock, and P2, which is a high priority process, will end up waiting for a low priority process, which is not something that we want. Formally this situation is called priority inversion. So you don't want that to happen. So what the kernel does instead is it wakes everybody up. The scheduler takes care of scheduling one of these processes. Whoever gets to run first will acquire the lock. And of course, then what we are depending on is we are assuming that the scheduler is fair and the scheduler will take care of starvation prevention. So because, I mean, sleep until unlocked is fine, but when you wake up, because the inode has become unlocked, because of this principle, you cannot assume that you already have a locked copy of the inode. So you will have to start from the beginning all over again, because right now P1, P2 and P3 are, all of them are in contention. So you start the process all over again. So that's kind of what's counterintuitive about this situation. Why this is an error, we've already talked about. These two are relatively straightforward. So now if you put all these four cases together, this is the algorithm as given in Bach's book. So the whole thing is you keep repeating until you're not done for the situation that I just talked about. I mean, you could be one of several processes waiting. If you wake up, you keep trying until you finally get a lock copy. So this is the simpler part. If the inode is in cache, then the two cases are either the inode is locked or it's not locked. Fine. So if it's locked, then you sleep until it is unlocked, and then you start from the beginning all over again. This is the kind of topmost case that we just talked about. That's the case over here. Okay. If the inode is not locked, then this is relatively simple. Basically, you can now return a locked copy of the inode. So somewhere here I should have written that you lock the inode. But it is possible that the particular inode entry that or the inode table entry that you are looking at is currently on the free disk. It is possible. In that case, I mean you'll be incrementing the reference count anyway. Special cases, if the reference count is going from 0 to 1, you also have to remove it from the free disk so that it is not accidentally assigned to any different time. So incrementing reference count and locking the inode are compulsory steps. Special case of this is if it goes from 0 to 1, remove it from the free disk. The other part is for corresponding to a cache miss, and if the free list is empty, this is the lowest case, you just return an error. Otherwise, you remove the buffer from the free list, you are going to use it in order to store one in-use copy of this inode. So you remove it from the free list, put it on the appropriate hash queue for this file system number, inode number. So now basically that buffer is in a position ready to for us to read data into. So then you actually read inode from the disk. Initialize reference count to 1. Again, missing statement over here is that to lock the inode and you read it. Okay. One kind of easy enough point, but I didn't talk about it earlier, so it might be used up over before completeness. I mean, when I say read inode from disk, you start with an inode number. Remember, for a particular file system, we can also, I mean, because we know the list of all fields contained within an inode, you can also work out the byte size for an inode. You know the block size of the file system, so you also know how many inodes will fit in one disk block. So then the math is fairly easy. If you know that your inode number is I, one small detail to keep track of, as I said, contrary to usual practice, inode numbers start from 1, valid inode numbers. So 0 would have made the arithmetic a little easier. Because it starts from 1, you have to do I minus 1. N is what? N is the number of inodes per block. This is, as I just said, you can work out. So this divided by N, and you take the quotient, that will give you which block has the inode. And remainder mod N will give you which N inode it is within the target block. So if you multiply this by the size of the disk inode, you have both a block number and a byte offset within the block. So kind of that detail you will require when you are reading inode from disk. So given an inode number, you will have to be able to locate which block and what byte offset within that block. Now suppose you are done with your file, either you are now closing the file or you called the iget because you wanted to do something like your chmod and permissions have been changed, so you now want to release the inode. So basically, so if you think about iput, which is the converse action of iget, you want to now release the inode. Essentially, what do we want to do? We want to decrease reference count . So this is really the most important thing that we want to do. So now, in order to make sure that this happens correctly, what do we need to do? This, remember, is a shared counter. So if your inode was locked, then you're fine. That means you do the iget and iput within one system call. Consider chmod, for example. You do an iget, modify the permission, and then you do an iput. So everything happens within one system call. That means your inode is already locked thanks to the I-gate. If on the other hand, the I-gate happened inside F-open and the I-put is happening inside F-close, then it is possible that your inode was not locked to start. So in that case, you have to lock the inode. Again, I mean, same principle that I mentioned earlier. Locks never last across system calls. So both the I-gate and I-put happen within a system call means you don't have to lock. The I-gate locked it, you're fine, you still have a lock. But in something like open-close separate system calls, it would have been unlocked before or just before the return from open. The lock inode, if not already locked. Okay, reference count drops or you decrement reference count. Just as in I-gate, we looked at the special case of reference count going from 0 to 1, in which case you move it out from the free list. In this case, if it goes from, say, like 3 to 2 to 1, that is not important. It's still currently in use. But if it drops from 1 to 0, you have to put it on the free list. Actually, there are some other things to be done first, so done around this step. So let me talk about the simpler and more obvious actions first, then I talk about a special case that is additionally handled here. Basically, why are we calling this I-put? There must have been an I-get earlier. That means that some process acquired a locked copy of the inode in order to do some operation on the inode. So examples of operations that we've seen are something like permission changing, owner changing. Maybe you open a file and write something to it. If the file has grown, then its file size has changed. Maybe you have additional entries in the inode table of contents. So maybe it was 2 blocks long, now it is maybe 10 blocks long. So in all these cases, the changes have so far happened to the memory copy. When you now kind of, if the reference count has dropped to 0, you are saying it's no longer in active use, so I will put it on the free list. Now if it is allocated from the free list for holding some other inode, then the modifications will be lost. So before I put it on the free list, I have to make sure that the disk copy of the inode is the same as the memory copy. So which also tells me that apart from the different kind of extra fields that I mentioned earlier that you hold in the inode cache, you should also keep a dirty bit. That is the memory copy and the disk copy same or different? So actually, offhand, I can't think of any situation where the inode would not be dirty. Because even if you are opening the file in read-only mode, the last access time will be changed So more or less anything you do to the file, you'll at least access the file or you'll change the inode. So the timestamp part will change. So this I think, can't hurt to write it, but what I'm thinking is maybe the inode will always be dirty. So you might as well just update the disk copy of the inode before putting the inode on the free list. Yes.
So I put the inode on the free list and without writing the note. Without writing note to the disk, without writing.
Money, you want to skip this step?
Yes.
But step. Okay.
Yes. Now whenever a new process want to use that inode, then I will do that one.
Sure. That's a possible design also. Except that, one possibility is that over here, if you want, you could do something like write the inode to disk asynchronously. So the buffer gets marked that it is in the process of being written. The kernel actually doesn't wait for the write to complete. So everything continues as usual. But notice that when you, if you make the process that is wanting a fresh inode wait, because the buffer is not dirty, because the buffer is dirty, then that process actually has to block. So that has to be synchronous. You have to first update the data and then you get it back. So from that point of view, I think this design, that will also be correct. But it will make the process wait when it is time to open. So maybe that way this is the preferable design. Okay, one special case, as I said, that we'll also have to handle over here is I'll fit it in somewhere over here later, but let me first say what situation we are trying to deal with. Think about removing a file. From what we talked about earlier, removing a file, basically how are we as users accessing a file? Via some path. So when you remove a file, you are basically removing it from that path, which means you are basically cutting a link. So removing a file, among other things, it will certainly change some entry in the containing directory data block, but it will also decrement the link count in the inode itself. So then that's a modification to the inode. So even inside RM, you will actually have to do an IGET, reduce the link count, and then do an IPUT. So until we have actually reduced the link count, we don't know if the link count has dropped to zero or not. So that means when the link count drops to zero, then we know that the inode is not actually no longer reachable within the file system. So that is when we can actually mark that this inode is free and can be allocated to some other file or directory. As opposed to an inode buffer being free for allocation to an inode cache another cache entry. So this we are talking about the actual disk copy of the inode. You remove a file, all links go away, that inode now becomes free for you. So that basically is some check that we do over here. If reference count drops to zero, you check. If link count is also zero, then marking the inode free corresponds to setting the, remember, every file has a type or every inode has an inode type. So a non-zero type means that the file or the inode is being used, and a zero type means that the inode is not allocated. So marking the inode free corresponds to setting the type field equal to zero. So if the file itself has gone, then no point holding on to the data block. So you go through the inode table of contents. All the blocks that were attached to this file, you can now release those data blocks. Those data blocks can then be reassigned to other files or directories. So there's some other things to be done as well. So we call the other things that need to be done in order to free up the inode, we call that. So this algorithm we have not looked at. This we look at next, after we are done with I get, I put, we will talk about I alloc and I free. Yeah, so I think after this, so I'm just checking if there is any overlap between what we do over here or whether it's all right to do this in sequence. So if the read count drops to zero, then you mark the inode free by setting the type to zero. So that's also an inode modification. Release all the data blocks.
Sir, can you give an example that the reference count is zero and read count is non-zero?
So any file that is, say you open, think of your earlier assignment that you are doing something like file copy from source to destination. Then inside the process, destination file has been opened, and since you are running your assignment, you may reasonably assume that nobody else has that file open. So in that case, your reference count will be 1. Link count will also be 1 because it exists only in that assignment directory. When you call the corresponding close, your link count will remain 1 because it's there in the directory, but your reference count will drop to 0 because there are no other instances of the file in use. Okay, that's the case you are looking for: reference count 0, link count non-zero. Okay, one kind of interesting side effect of this is that, I mean, consider the following situation. You are currently using a file, which means, I mean, you have the file open somewhere. In some other terminal, you delete the file. Then think of what is going to happen. So you're kind of, you have the same file open for reading. Say, think of the following. I mean, you are reading, or say you are viewing a movie. Then your media player has the file open in read mode. So from a terminal, you delete the file. Then what happens is, over here there'll be an I get. Remove the or decrement the link count. Link count happens to become 0 in this case. And then you call an iput. So the iput decrements the reference count. But notice your reference count is now 1 rather than 0. So in fact, it will not do any of this. Which means, I mean, all that your deletion will do is it will decrement the link count in the inode and exit. Your file and the inode and the data continue to remain available. So your file whatever instance or instances of the file that you have opened, they will continue to work without any problem. When your media player closes the file, that is when the file will actually physically be deleted. So that's when the reference count will drop to 0. Then the special case handling will be done, and then you will discover that the link has actually now dropped to 0. After that, the file will be deleted. So different operating systems handle this situation differently. On Windows, I think you get an error message saying something like that the file is currently in use, so you won't be able to delete it. Over here, or on Unix-like file systems, you remove a file. Any instance that is currently actively using the file will be able to continue to use it without any error. Once that file is closed, or once all active instances are closed, the file is actually deleted.
Is it deleted under which system is still there? It's become a dangling kind of thing. If the name count is zero, but still the reference count is.
Right. So notice that you won't be able to reopen the file anymore.
Yeah,
it's not reachable in the path. But something that already opened it, I mean the inode is not thrown away. So the inode table of contents are there.
Okay, that copy is allowing me to do this reading.
Right. So you can continue reading, writing, whatever. Eventually, of course, when you release it, then if you wrote into a disk, into a file that has been removed, meanwhile, then it will get thrown away.
So, what is the content of the information is that I know when this is deleted, because there is no path name existing.
Right.
Under that, ownership, path name, and all this information. So, for that time, it is like anomalous information in my time.
Right? Notice that that information comes from the, the file name comes from the directory data block.
Mm-hmm.
So that entry has now been marked invalid,
mm-hmm.
which means you are not going to be able to access the file anymore. But the information in the inode, which corresponds to things like who is the owner, timestamp, all of those remain what they were previously. So it continues to remain your file until such time as the open instance gets closed, at which point you'll be able to delete it.
So in this case, the link count is zero.
If there was only one link to the file and you deleted it while it was open somewhere else, the link count will drop to zero.
The thing is that I opened using a gedit.
Okay.
And I opened this thing using acronym. Okay. Now I deleted that file. Now it will remain open.
Okay. Editors are trickier because very often what they do is they read the file buffer or the file into internal buffers and they'll manipulate those buffers. So at any point of time, you can do things like choose to save as. So all of that data is maintained in the editor's buffer. Whereas, in fact, I think I am not 100% sure about how media players work. One simple way to do it would be open it at the beginning, and when the user tweets the viewer, you close the file. That would be one way of working. I'm not sure there's any advantage to doing it differently, but at least one possible way would be that you open the file, read a part of it and kind of cache it, close the file. And the kind of tail end of the file you read later only if required to do so. I mean, in which case you'll have to open the file again. But I don't see any advantage to doing that. So I think the example that I gave should hold. I mean, you create a copy, open it in some movie player, and delete the file. My expectation is that the movie should still play until the end of the movie.
Sir, if the movie is long enough and it doesn't fit in the memory, so
that's what I think. I mean, it will depend on whether the file is opened once or several times. If the file is opened once in the beginning and closed at the end, even then, I mean, notice that the inode is not thrown away until you close the last instance of the file. So that's contained in the inode. So if you're not throwing the inode away, the table of contents remains what it was. So in fact, what you can do is, no, one part. Sorry, forget about it. But try this experiment out and see if it plays till the end. I mean, you should be able to do things like fast forward, backward, everything within the file. All of that contingent on that one assumption that there is one open and one close in such a media.
Suppose this media example, media player, movie example. Like, we have a file that we are running, right? And And obviously that is not kept in one block, that is kept in multiple blocks. And all those information are kept in my iNode. Now when I deleted it, all those data blocks are invalid?
No, not yet. So this is where we are, actually limiting the data blocks. Until your reference count drops to zero, you don't actually do anything at all.
But at the same time, suppose for the file system, is that space is freed? Because
no,
at the same time, if I want to create a new file, and which has only that place left data block I'm talking, so it won't be allowed.
You won't be able. So try this. I mean, if you take a small pen drive, say 4 gigabytes, and keep some movie that is almost that big, play it, remove it, and try to copy another move. So I mean, take a long enough movie so it will play for at least 15-30 minutes. Remove it and try copying another movie into that place. It should still say no space left on device. Try it out, then we will confirm whether things work as we expect them. Right, okay, so maybe we can possibly look at the algorithm.
Sir, what happens for the swap files, for EIOP files? There is a buffered file named .swap. So it is actually there in the disk.
Correct.
So, I mean, how is it, I mean, the VIE is responsible for opening the file and removing the file when the file is actually saved.
Right. So for it's something like an auto-save file.
Okay.
So for as long as you don't save yourself, it will keep writing changes to that SWP
kind of
file.
Whenever it's dirty, it will continue writing the in the buffer.
Right. This is a more readable version of this is already there. So okay, so you lock iNode, if not already locked, this you need to do so that you can decrement the reference count. If the reference count is zero, first thing you do is you check the link count is equal to zero. When the link count drops to zero, then you free all the disk blocks, set the file type equal to zero, and call IC. IC, remember, is a routine we have to discuss. Next, I mean, other than this special case, in general, if the iNode has been changed, then you update the disk copy and you put the iNode on the free disk. So more mostly kind of a more readable version of this is already up. So this was, I mean, iGet and iPut correspond to when we have a particular file that we want to access or open and we need its iNode. Specifically, we need this iNode in the iNode cache. What about when you are creating a new file or directory? And conversely, when you are deleting a file or a directory? So the pair of subroutines that we want to look at are iAllocate and iFree. Since this is the way our file system is organized at the lowest level, if you make use of one point that has come up earlier in the discussion, then that is that sure, I mean, since we are using iNode and entries in the iNode cache, both of them in the same context, so make sure that you are clear in your mind about when we are referring to the actual disk iNode and when we are referring to the memory copy. So here what I mean is, the disk copy of the iNode, if its type field is zero, that means that it has not been assigned to any file or directory or whatever. Otherwise, it would have a non-zero type field. So one possible way would be anytime you need a new inode in order to create a new file or directory, the kernel could in principle start scanning from here until it finds an inode that has a type field of 0. Except that this involves an actual disk operation. And you will have to read the first block, scan the inodes in that block. If you find something, fine, otherwise you read the next block and so forth. So that's not a very quick way of allocating a new inode. So what the kernel does instead, at least on SVR2 systems, is initially it will say just after the file has been, just after the file system has been created, that means you've just formatted a new partition, it will do the scan. And remember, we have the boot block here and the super block here. So within the super block, it will keep a list of so it will scan this, it will find which inodes have type field 0, and it will take those numbers and put them on a list inside the super block. And in general, especially when your file system is kind of just being created, you will have a lot, a very large number of free inodes here. And the list inside the super block may not be large enough to hold that completely. That's not a problem. So basically what it does, what the kernel does is, it will scan from here, find the block inode numbers that are free, put those numbers on the super block list. If you run out of space on the super block list, just mark that I have already scanned up to this point. So that's called the so-called remembered inode. So the remembered inode is essentially marking up to which point the kernel had already scanned. So now if you, as a user, if you want a new, you want to create a new file or directory, the kernel can take one of the numbers from this list and give you that you use this inode number for whatever purpose you want. So then this list starts getting depleted. When you actually, or when the kernel has handed out all the free inode numbers from this list, then it will have no option but to scan the disk again. So you start, the kernel scans again from the remembered inode, and instead of kind of doing it one at a time, it will scan, it will repopulate this list, and then again hand out from this list. So basically what happens is, instead of a disk operation happening for every inode that you need, it happens periodically. I mean, if you are the unlucky user who happens to need a free inode just after the last free inode has been handed out, then your file operation or directory creation will take slightly longer, but other operations will happen quickly. One additional kind of improvement that you can do over here is, supposing a file gets deleted. So already we've seen how you mark the type field on the disk inode to 0. What you can additionally do is put the free inode number on this list if there is space. So if you are kind of rapidly creating and deleting lots of files, then instead of kind of finishing this and then scanning from the disk, anything that you delete, those numbers get put back in this list. So it takes a little longer for the list to become empty.
So you said that keeping a marker till the time
it has scanned, but if some inode previous to that has got released, then it will start from the remaining number. Correct, correct, absolutely, absolutely. So basically, in fact, that ends up causing problems also. But usually what happens is, if you have a free inode, something over here happens to get freed up, normally you will try to put it on the list of free i-nodes. Now suppose the list of free i-nodes is already full. What you could do is update the remembered i-node to point to, I mean, so your remembered i-node was here, you now freed something over here, so you update the remembered i-node field to point here. So what you are trying to maintain all the time is that the remembered i-node points to the first free i-node on the list. Except that, I mean, when we look at the details, you see that that is all, that update operation is also not done sometimes, which means you could get into a situation where the remembered i-node points here and there are actually other free i-nodes to the left of the remembered i-node. So that situation could arise and it leads to problems because of which the i-allocate looks a little counterintuitive. So maybe we look at this also. Remember, everything that we are dealing with, we are dealing with memory copies. And as we've just discussed, because i-alloc and i-free end up manipulating this list, so we are talking about adding or removing elements from a shared list. So that means the super block will also have to be locked in order to do operations on these shared data structures. So i-alloc or i-free, the first thing it will have to check is the super block locked? Only then I can manipulate this shared data structure. So if you look at i-alloc, so you first check, is the super block locked? If it is locked, then you have to sleep until the super block becomes unlocked. For the same reason that we discussed earlier, there may be several processes sleeping, waiting for the super block to become unlocked. The kernel will wake all of them up. So after waking up, you cannot assume, as before, that you have the super block to yourself. So you have to start all over again, competing with all other processes in order to get a lock on the super block. So eventually, hopefully, this succeeds. And now you come to a point where you get access to, or exclusive access to, the super block.
So isn't the three blocks are removed after it is after a process acquires it from the super block?
Sorry, say that again.
Like you said that we have a lock on the super block,
mm-hmm.
but if two processes are coming to use it, so once it gets a free i-node, that is removed from the super block.
Sure.
But so why there is a need of lock on this? It is not getting shared anymore.
No, but I mean, see, what if you are, you have two processes that are concurrently trying to access the super block. So you have two processes, both of which want.
So I have multiple resources in that super block. There is a list of free.
Yes, but you want to kind of, you want to essentially remove an element from that list, right?
Okay, but both of them are trying to get the same element. Right?
Something like that, correct. I mean, you have to keep track of, I mean, you have a list of numbers, mm-hmm. you have a pointer to which was the last element handed out, or which is the first element waiting to be handed out. So there'll be an increment from that. So for those reasons, you need to synchronize access to the super block. So again, inside i-alloc, I mean, fine, so you kind of, primary step is that you lock the super block. When you have exclusive access to the super block, again there will be two cases. This is the easy case. So the way the code is structured is you check whether the super block list is empty. If it is, then you start from the remembered inode, read one block of the disk at a time, scan it for whether you have inodes that have type equal to 0. If you find inodes with type 0, then you put their numbers on the inode fields. So you keep doing this. You add free inode numbers to the super block list until either the super block list becomes full or you reach the end of the inode list. Because you searched up to a point, you update the remembered inode, from which point the next scan will start when the list becomes empty again. Of course, if you in the whole scan you find that there are no free inodes at all, then of course it's an error because you can't, you run out of inodes in the file system, it won't be possible to create any more files or data. Once you've done this, once you've taken care of this case, you may now assume that your super block free list is not empty. So then one would imagine that all it takes is kind of, since you already have exclusive access to the super block, simply remove the super block or remove the first entry from that list of free inode numbers and give it to the requesting process. So you start out by doing that. So basically you remove the first available free inode number from this list. You get an inode number. Then you call iget, which is what we just discussed. You call iget on that inode number. So you want to get a locked copy of that inode in the inode cache, and you want to return that locked copy to the user. For fairly strange reasons, you get an inode number from the list of free inode numbers, but then when you call iget and you get the actual cached copy of the inode number in the inode cache, in certain peculiar situations, you may actually find that it is in use. That means it has already been allocated to somebody else before. What I'm essentially saying is that you can actually have an inode which is in use and assigned to some file or directory, but you still get that free inode number from the free list here. How, I haven't talked about, but we'll talk about that a little later. Because of that, you have to check. You get an inode number from the super block list, call iget with that number, and then you check, is the inode, I expect it to be free, but is it really free? If it's not free, then notice that this iget incremented the reference count, but I don't really have any use for it. I won't be able to use it because it's allocated to something else. So I have to call the matching iput over here, and then I have to start the whole process all over again, right from the beginning. Other than this peculiar condition, what you normally expect is that you get an inode number, get a copy of that inode in the cache, initialize the inode. Most important thing about initializing the inode is to set its type field to something non-zero. And then make sure that the disk copy of the inode is also, that non-zero type field is recorded on the disk copy also. You decrement the overall free inode count, and then you can return. Remember, this inode was obtained by iget, so what you actually get back from ialoc is also a lock. So the other easier way to remember ialoc is that, keep in mind that ialoc internally contains a call to iget. Okay. So why this happens? What's the time now, please? Okay, that's best not discussed at the end of a long day. So this we'll do tomorrow morning. So next class is tomorrow, right? Okay, so tomorrow morning I'll explain why that race condition arises. Just as a kind of hint, notice that there is a gap here. What kind of gap? I'm saying you initialize the inode here, so the memory copy now has a non-zero type field. But the disk copy still has a type field of 0. Until this write completes, there is an inconsistency between what you have in memory and what you have on disk. And that is basically one of the causes that contributes to this very counterintuitive behavior. Details we'll work out tomorrow. So anyway, when we work that out, I think I'll also quickly go through this again. So you'll get a chance to revise IL also. Okay, so that's all for today.